mornings like this that make this coffee taste like warrior juice that has been decanted from the nipple of some Nordic marauder. It just makes you feel superhuman. So thanks very much. Actually surprised by how much interest has been caused by the iMac thing. I guess I wasn't underestimating how many of us are kind of going, God, what shall I do? So I'm going to do a full-on review in the second week of March. What I will be doing in the interim weeks is running control tests on my existing dustbin. So it'll be interesting to know what control tests you'd like me to run. I'll check out all of your comments and see if I can accommodate. So I'm definitely going to do a kind of a contact count, see how many counts of contact I can get. I'm going to do like a super mega Pro Tools 5.1, loads of different reverbs, see how far I can go before breaking it. And I'm going to do some bounce out tests, both audio and to video, anything else you can think of. And later on in this video, I've got a couple of like early thoughts about the iMac and a couple of little mini tests that I've done. I thought I'd respond to a couple of you have requested that I do a drum programming video, because I used to be a drum programmer. I don't know, it's a bit like, all right, me old codgers, this is how you get a slamming drum and bass track down and watch those flams. So, I guess this is going to be a tutorial of how to drum programs when you're senile. Now, how to program drums like an old man.
So basically, I'm going to show you the three different ways that I've worked over the years working with drums. One is just construction kit, playing something in and then editing that just like you would anything you do orchestrally. Then with audio, which is less familiar for me, but I think an important way to show you. And then with loops and samples. So I've got this Hedley Grange kit, Chad Smith from the Red Hot Chili Peppers. The way I program is just to play it. That kind of stuff. I'm a little bit rusty. Little Steve Ferroni chop there. I think the first thing to realise is that playing it in won't give you the detail that you need. So let's just lay down a simple beat using the ride, and I'm going to fill in what I consider to be the gaps. So I'm going to also have a kind of a pedaled. Okay, so this drum, this kick drum, is all feeling rather kind of the same velocity. It doesn't have the kind of the dynamic you would expect of a live player to give it, you know, helps it kind of swing the beat a bit. Okay, these ghost notes, these little kind of snare bounces, they're a bit too loud as well. And those are the kind of the intentional part of the beat. Maybe just a little top. And then what I'm also going to do is I'm going to put some really quiet ghost notes, which is just more just the natural thing of the stick being bounced. Also, going to just take it so it's a little bit less on the one with the ride and more on the off. So let's just take those down. So that's got more of a kind of loopy, funky, groovy feel to it. Now let's have a go at recreating the Amen break. Okay, so let's bounce that down as a bit of audio. CH, Amen. And then what we can do is just grab that. I'm just going to cut that first bit, otherwise kind of we're going to labour this too much. But you'll be surprised how flexible audio can be. So if I go to events, I can actually quantize that to kind of like a bouncy, let's really make that bounce along. More. Now, you're probably noticing that it's a bit kind of glitchy. So what I'm going to do is, the trick is to drag back If you go the other way, you'll bang into some more hits. So if we go like this and then like that. Great thing about Logic is you can do this to multiple things at a time. I'm just going to do 25 crossfades. And obviously you need to fiddle around with it, and I'm not, as I say, an expert, but audio is surprisingly versatile. But the way I like to do things is to build my own sample instrument. Surprise, surprise. So I'm just going to show you how I do that and then how I would apply it into a kind of a drum and bass kind of context. So let's get up a new sample instrument. Okay, so I'm just going to make that sit on the root key. Tune that to D, D3. And what I tend to do is, what I would do is, I would get the beat and I'd chop key moments. But just for the sake of expediency, I'm going to do on this one, I'm just going to chop it to the first snare hit. Okay, and then let's put it up to drum and bass. It's a lot faster these days, but in my day it was 160, maybe 163. So let's do that, 163. I'm just going to show you how I tune that all up and then just do a little kind of fiddle around with the loop. Okay, so you can see it's considerably faster. Okay, so you can hear there's a little gap at the end. That means it's kind of run out of sample, which means it's running too fast. And then you just kind of have fun. Then all you need is your electric piano and then a big old pad. Sculpture modelling synth. And the last thing you need for this is... sorts of fun with. Well, it's nice to go back to that little zone. Fond memories. So I don't know, that was basically the starting point for my career as a drum programmer, and that kind of morphed into working on stuff to picture, but basically those principles, drumming something up, turning it into loops, manipulating the loops.
So actually what I didn't do is I didn't compress Chad's drums, which I would have done, and then the track that you heard at the beginning of this film, I smashed the fast sped up sample drums with compression, degraded it a bit, reduced the stereo image, applied a bit of compression and EQ to the keyboards, and then I smashed the whole thing.
So I thought I'd do a quick render test on my video editing software, Premiere Pro, with the iMac Pro. So on my Mac Pro, which is 6-core, 3.5 megahertz, 16 gigabytes, I rendered out episode 85, which is quite a long episode, linked below. And I started rendering at 7:39, finished at 8:27, which is a render time of 48 minutes. Now on this, I rendered it at 11:12, and it finished at 11:36, meaning 24 minutes, so exactly half the render time, which for 4K video is pretty impressive. The screen is absolutely gorgeous, no problems there, I don't miss my old screen whatsoever. However, one reservation, fan noise. The Mac Pro is pretty much silent, unless your ear is right up next to it, certainly if it's around the back of your desk, no problems there at all for a recording studio environment. But with this, obviously with video editors, animators, 3D people, you know, the fan noise doesn't really matter as much. But I'm concerned that if running in real time, say a very big arrangement that you're maybe adding, say, an acoustic guitar over the top of,
whether this is going to interfere. So I'm going to run tests with a noise meter, because that was a bit of a shock. And obviously, with other computers, you can just kind of store them away, put them in a machine room, or, you know, one of those little cabinets where you can close the door and the fan noise is obliterated. But not if it's your screen. Anyway, we'll get to the bottom of it.
So anyway, back to the Warrior Juice. Thanks, as always, for your support. If you're new to the channel, hit subscribe. This week's going to be particularly interesting. And if you like what I do, hit like.